the President of the Carnegie Institution for Science, former Chairman of the United States Nuclear Regulatory Commission, and member of the Academy Council and Trust, the Honorable Richard Meserve.
Well, I must admit, I come up here and I see this impressive array of placards, and I sort of think there's a quiz. Which of these names does not belong? We now have an opportunity for each of our distinguished honorees today to make some brief comments, and then we're going to have a panel discussion. And I think, Dr. Drell, I think you're first.
Okay. Well, thank you very much for this award. To me, an academic scientist, this award from the Distinguished American Academy is a great honor indeed. As you heard, Benjamin Thompson, or Count Rumford, established this prize to recognize contributions to advancing our understanding of nature, and with particular emphasis on understanding light and heat, which in the words of the Academy can be very broadly interpreted. Early in my career as a theoretical physicist, my primary goal was to make such contributions, but over time I realized that I could not escape the reality that progress in nuclear science made back in the 1920s and 1930s had led to terrifying new dangers to the very survival of our civilization on a global scale. I'm speaking of nuclear weapons, of course, capable of unimaginable destructiveness. And increasingly, I found my scientific work drawn to the challenge to prevent the nightmare of that sort from occurring. And this opened a second track in my career and led to my forming working bonds and friendships with political scientists and government leaders, such as my fellow honorees here with me today. I want to recognize the importance of the American Academy and its committees on international security, and in particular, the leadership of my good and longtime friend, Paul Doty, in helping me form such bonds. And so today I'm being honored here for contributing to an effort not to advance our understanding of heat and light, but to get rid of the means of creating here on Earth explosions that produce such monstrous quantities of heat and light and other forms of energy that they could destroy us all. Now, since this initiative presents technical as well as political challenges, and as you've heard, Count Rumford was a physicist who was also interested very much in gunpowder and in various forms of armaments in general, I guess it's reasonable to conclude that awarding this prize this way fits appropriately in the guidelines as the Count set them down to the American Academy. Now, the only way I know to get rid of the means of creating devastatingly destructive explosions that pose a threat to our civilization is to dismantle and destroy all nuclear weapons. Realizing the vision of a world free of nuclear weapons is precisely the goal of our program. It is the vision that President Ronald Reagan and General Secretary Mikhail Gorbachev brought to their remarkable summit in Reykjavik, Iceland in 1986. Although they failed to close the deal, recall that in 1986, the Berlin Wall still stood, and we were still in the midst of the Cold War. Gorbachev and Reagan did start down the path of reducing the sizes of these bloated nuclear arsenals. However, without a vision of a world free of nuclear weapons as a guide beam, the nations of the world have not pursued the measures that could reduce nuclear dangers that we face with the intensity and the boldness that the times require. No doubt, rekindling or realizing the vision will be a very difficult goal to achieve. It will require nothing less than a new deal between states that have nuclear weapons and those who, for now at least, have volunteered to forego them. Progress will require cooperation on a global scale between nations with very different economic and strategic aspirations, as well as forms of governance. We recognize this in our program and have proposed a series of steps that we consider both practical and necessary for the United States to take, together with other nations in the world, to begin the journey and convince skeptics that our vision is not a flight of fancy, but a practical goal. We have been encouraged by strong and broad international support. There are also, of course, some who have protested that our initiative is not only futile, but even unwise and dangerous as a distraction from a policy of nuclear deterrence. After all, the United States and the former Soviet Union relied on nuclear deterrence to navigate successfully through the perilous years of the Cold War. And against what seemed to me to be insurmountable odds, not one of the many thousands of existing nuclear weapons was detonated in military combat, although there were numerous opportunities to do so. But it would be dangerously wrong to draw comfort from that achievement. Relying on nuclear weapons for deterrence is becoming increasingly hazardous and decreasingly effective in a world with the accelerating spread of nuclear know-how, weapons, and material. Today, we are teetering in the world on the edge of a new and more perilous nuclear era, facing a growing danger that nuclear weapons, the most devastating instrument of annihilation ever invented, may fall into the hands of those who do not shrink from mass murder on an unprecedented scale. With the spread of advanced technology and renewed interest on the international front in nuclear technology for civil power generation, as we heard earlier, the threat of such a catastrophe looms more and more likely. What will it take to prevent such a catastrophe? First, a sense of urgency that was lacking when two bold leaders, Ronald Reagan and Mikhail Gorbachev, posed the challenge to escape the trap of nuclear deterrence at Reykjavik in 1986. It is lacking today. And second, strong leadership with the United States at the helm, but not alone, with partners to create, to inspire a sense of urgency. This means forging an effective international effort to implement a set of practical steps, such as we have proposed, to prevent the proliferation of nuclear weapons. And just as rekindling the vision of Reykjavik will be essential for these steps to be broadly accepted as fair and urgent, as said in the Wall Street Journal letter, the steps themselves are essential to achieve that vision, a world free of nuclear weapons. There is a lot of work to do. Thank you again for this honor.
Dr. Perry?
For the last few years, working to reduce the nuclear danger has taken up most of my time. Indeed, it has become a top priority in my life. And that is because I believe that the gravest danger facing the world today is a terror group detonating a nuclear bomb in one of our cities. And I fear that this danger is not remote. But it is also true that my experiences during the Cold War have conditioned me to be especially sensitive about the dangers of nuclear weapons. To make this point, I will share one experience with you that occurred to me during the most dangerous period of the Cold War, when I was the Undersecretary of Defense for Research and Engineering. During the summer of 1978, I was awoken at 3 o'clock in the morning by a phone call from the watch officer at the North American Air Defense Command. As I sleepily picked up the telephone, the general got right to the point. He told me that his computers were indicating 200 ICBMs on the way from the Soviet Union to the United States. I immediately woke up. Of course, that was a false alarm, but the general had had only 15 minutes to reach that judgment. He was calling me in the hopes that I could help him determine what had gone wrong so that he would have a good explanation when he briefed the president the next morning. That call, of course, is engraven in my memory, but it is only one of three false alarms that occurred during my tenure in office, and I do not know how many more might have occurred in the Soviet Union. So the risk of a nuclear catastrophe was never academic to me. Ironically, during that same period, I was responsible for the development of our country's nuclear weapons. During my tenure, I supervised the development of the B-2 bomber, the MX missile, the Trident submarine, the Trident missile, the air-launched cruise missile, the ground-launched cruise missile, the sea-launched cruise missile, all of them. While I saw clearly the risks in building this deadly nuclear arsenal, I believed that at the time it was necessary to take those risks with the threats we faced during the Cold War. But after the Cold War ended, I believed that it was no longer necessary to take those terrible risks. And I believed that we should begin to dismantle this deadly Cold War legacy. My first opportunity to act on this belief came in 1993, when I was invited by Secretary of Defense, by President Clinton, to become the Secretary of Defense. As the Secretary, my first priority was to begin the dismantlement of the Cold War nuclear arsenal. The greatest immediate danger was that the nuclear weapons in Ukraine, Kazakhstan, and Belarus would fall into the hands of terrorists. The tools that I had available to deal with this were the START Treaty, in which Secretary George Shultz had played a key role, the Nunn-Lugar program, in which Senator Sam Nunn had played a key role, and the cooperation of Russia. My major concern was the nuclear arsenal of Ukraine. When the Soviet Union collapsed, Ukraine had inherited all of the nuclear weapons then on its soil. At the time, they had more nuclear weapons than the United Kingdom, France, and China combined. Worse, they were going through a period of social, economic, and political chaos. Fortunately, the Ukrainian government made a courageous and enlightened decision to give up their nuclear weapons, and using the Nunn-Lugar program, we assisted them in the dismantlement process. With the permission of the Ukrainian president, I personally supervised the dismantlement of their nuclear weapons. I visited four times their primary ICBM base at Pervomysk, which at the time had 700 nuclear warheads, all aimed at targets in the United States. On the first visit, I went to the control center and observed a practice countdown. After that unnerving experience, I then observed the removal of the first batch of warheads. On my second visit, I observed the removal of the first batch of missiles for dismantlement. On my third visit, I joined the Ukrainian and Russian defense ministers in pressing the buttons that blew up the first batch of silos. Then in the summer of 1996, I returned to Pervomysk for my final visit. I went with the Ukraine and Russian ministers to the site where the silos had previously been, and together we planted sunflowers at that site. During my term in office, we dismantled about 10,000 nuclear warheads in the United States and in the former Soviet Union, and we helped three nations to go from being nuclear powers to non-nuclear powers. This was the first time since the dawn of the nuclear age when proliferation had actually been reversed, and I thought we were well on the way. But since then, the efforts to reduce the nuclear danger have stalled and even reversed. Both Russia and China are now developing new nuclear warheads. The STAR Treaty expires in 2009, and there have been no further treaties to dismantle nuclear weapons. The United States has not yet ratified the Comprehensive Test Ban Treaty signed more than 10 years ago. India and Pakistan have gone nuclear. AQ Khan has covertly sold Pakistan's nuclear technology to an unknown number of nations. North Korea has built a small quantity of nuclear weapons and tested one of them. Iran is developing a capability to produce a nuclear fuel, which, if completed, would give it the option of building nuclear weapons within a few months. And if Iran and North Korea proceed on their present path, there is a real danger of a veritable cascade of nuclear proliferation. All of this is happening in parallel with the emergence of catastrophic terrorism. 9/11 made real to the United States, and indeed the world, the danger of catastrophic terrorism. But a nuclear bomb detonated in one of our cities would dwarf 9/11 in its catastrophic effects. It is impossible to overstate the human, the social, the economic, and the political catastrophe that would result in from such a detonation. It must be the priority of all nations to work seriously to head off that catastrophe. The nuclear powers have a special responsibility in that regard, and I believe that the United States must lead the way. One way our new president can demonstrate American leadership is by embracing the goals of our nuclear security project. Since the initiation of this project last January, I believe that we have turned a corner in dealing with the nuclear danger. More than a century ago, Victor Hugo wrote, "More powerful than the tread of mighty armies is an idea whose time has come." I believe that working to eliminate this deadly nuclear legacy is an idea whose time has finally come. But I also believe that it will take decades to achieve the final goals of the project. Thus, we must be training a new generation of security specialists to carry on the task as we retire from the scene. All of the members of our nuclear security project are in their 70s and 80s, and friends ask us why we are still working on security projects. Indeed, I work every day at Stanford with young security specialists, and I will happily pass the baton to them when I retire from the scene. But I'm not ready to do that yet. Indeed, when asked why I'm still teaching, why I'm still taking red eyes to Washington, and why I do not retire to some pleasant grove, I reply with words inspired by Robert Frost. "The woods are lovely, dark, and deep, but I have promises to keep and mouths to go before I sleep, and mouths to go before I sleep." Thank you.
The only statement, and I hate to admit this in this crowd of geniuses, but the only statement I disagree with this morning is the quote from Einstein where he said politics was more difficult than physics. I went to Georgia Tech for 3 years, then I dropped into law school, and then I descended into the practice of law and political career. So to me, physics was a pretty tough subject. I also would note that walking around at the Academy last evening and reading those wonderful, wonderful letters George Washington wrote, his acceptance in, of course, 1780, in the middle of the Revolution. Also, the tremendous letter that Thomas Jefferson penned and Alexander Hamilton. And I had this horror that I was going to have to go back and look at the letter that I wrote in acceptance in 1997 when you were so kind as to invite me to join the Academy. So I think I will refrain from doing that. But I'm deeply grateful to be here today and to receive this wonderful honor from the Academy. When you look at the history of the Academy and its contribution to the expansion and enhancement of knowledge, it is truly awesome and humbling. And when you think, when I think of receiving this Rumford Award with George Shultz and Bill Perry and Sid Drell, three of our nation's most effective and brilliant leaders, somehow I am reminded of the Camelot character by the name of Modred, of whom Lady Guinevere once observed, quoting her, "The only thing I can say for him is that he is bound to marry well because everybody is above him." So I am honored to be an apprentice in this group of mature leaders. Secretary Dean Acheson, and George Shultz will identify with this, I'm sure, was once asked to define foreign policy. He thought a moment and he replied, "Foreign policy is one damn thing after another." I realized at a relatively young age that nuclear weapons were not just another thing, but that indeed they held hostage the future of mankind. I was a 24-year-old lawyer for the House Armed Services Committee on a three-week Air Force trip to Europe when the Cuban Missile Crisis broke out. During this period, while the world held its breath, our delegation met at Ramstein Air Force Base in Germany with the head of U.S. Air Force Europe. The general explained that in the event of war, he had only a couple of minutes to launch all of what were known as quick reaction aircraft, or they would be destroyed. These planes and these forward bases were the first target for the Soviets because they would deliver the first nuclear weapons to strike the Soviet Union, or at least that's what the Soviet Union anticipated. The fact that the fate of mankind rested on the shoulders of only a few people on each side, who had only a few moments, as Bill Perry described, to decide whether to launch nuclear weapons, made a lasting impression on me, and I made a pledge to myself then, if I ever had a chance to work on the problem, I was going to tackle it. Today, the Cold War is over, but we face new nuclear dangers. I believe that the greatest danger, and I think Bill just said this, but I agree with him completely, the greatest danger we face is the possibility of a catastrophic nuclear attack by a terrorist group that does not have a return address and therefore is unlikely to be deterred. As those of us being honored today have pointed out, the accelerating spread of nuclear weapons, nuclear materials, and nuclear know-how has brought us to a nuclear tipping point. We are indeed in a race between cooperation and catastrophe. I ask myself frequently in the work I'm in two questions. The day after a nuclear attack on one of the cities of the world, what would we wish we had done to prevent it? Second question, why aren't we doing it now? In our Wall Street Journal article, we call for building a solid consensus for reversing reliance on nuclear weapons globally as a vital contribution to preventing their proliferation and ultimately ending them as a threat to the world. We are all keenly aware that the quest for a world free of nuclear weapons is fraught with many, many practical challenges. We've taken aim at those challenges by laying out a number of steps, which I believe are doable even though they are very difficult. We cannot reduce the nuclear threat without taking these steps. We cannot take these steps without the cooperation of other nations. We cannot get the cooperation of other nations without the vision of ending these weapons as a threat to the world. The reaction of many people to the vision of a world without nuclear weapons comes in two parts. On the one hand, most people say, boy, that would be great. Their second thought is, we simply can't get there from here. But there is hope. In the early 1990s, under Bill Perry's capable leadership as the Secretary of Defense, we made a deal to buy highly enriched uranium from the Russians that was in their warheads that were aimed at us, blend it down, and make it into nuclear fuel and use it in our power plants. Today, after a number of years in working on that program, again, we have made tremendous progress. If you think about it, 20% of the electricity in the United States is supplied by nuclear power, approximately 20%. 50% of the nuclear fuel that goes into that nuclear power is supplied by highly enriched uranium that has been blended into low-enriched uranium and made into nuclear fuel that was 20, 25 years ago in warheads aimed at the United States. So when you look at the lights in this room or any other room in America, theoretically, 10% of those light bulbs are fueled by material that was in the form of weapons aimed at America in the 1970s and the 1980s. There is hope. Swords to plowshares. We have hope. When I think about the nuclear goal of a free world, of a world free of nuclear weapons, to me it's like a very tall mountain. It's tempting and easy to say we can't get there from here. It's true that today our troubled world cannot even see the top of the mountain. But we can see that we're heading down, not up. We can see that we must turn around, that we must take paths leading to higher ground, and that we must get others to move with us. I'm profoundly grateful to the Academy for telling the world through this award how urgent it is for the survival of humanity that we stop our descent and find paths up the mountain toward a world free of nuclear weapons. Thank you.
I share with my colleagues gratitude to the Academy for this award. It's a great honor. But also, as Sam just said, it's a way of calling attention to the urgency of this program. And I might say in that connection, I welcome and applaud the Academy's continuing interest in your own program of working on this. By this time in the program, what more is there to say? Well, I've thought of two things. First of all, I'm struck by the contrast between how what happened at Reykjavik was greeted and how the initiative that we've taken has struck people. So I want to talk about that and ask why the difference in reaction. And then second, I'd like to discuss a little bit some of the implications of moving ahead for the status of our diplomatic capability and the way it should be conducted. First of all, Reykjavik. There we were in this tiny room in Hofti House in Reykjavik, a table maybe about not quite as long as this table, about two or three times as wide. On one end sits President Ronald Reagan, on the other, General Secretary Mikhail Gorbachev. I had the privilege of sitting beside President Reagan. My counterpart, the Soviet Foreign Minister Edward Shevardnadze, sat beside General Secretary Gorbachev, and there we were for two full days, and we talked about a huge range of issues. But the main emphasis was on an effort to reduce the number of nuclear weapons that each side held. And in the course of the discussion, we found ourselves agreeing, Reagan and Gorbachev found themselves agreeing on the desirability of eliminating nuclear weapons altogether. Well, there were no leaks from the Reykjavik meeting because we just told everything that happened. And when I got back to Washington, Margaret Thatcher had arrived. She summoned me to the British ambassador's residence. And I learned about a verb in the British language. You remember Margaret used to carry a little handbag, a hard handbag all the time. Well, in the British language, there is a verb called to be handbagged. And I got handbagged. I really got handbagged. And she said, George, how could you sit there and allow the president to agree to eliminating nuclear weapons? I said, Margaret, he's the president. And she said, no, but you're supposed to be the one with his feet on the ground and keep things stable. I said, but Margaret, I agreed with him. Oh, boy. But her reaction was more dramatic than most, but it was the general reaction in Washington that this was a crazy idea. Now, 20 years or so later, we published this article. and the reaction is entirely different. Yes, there's some people that don't like the idea, but interestingly, most of them think that the steps will move us toward a safer world. But the positive reaction has been astonishing. By this time, something like 3/4 of the former Secretaries of State and Defense and National Security Advisors have publicly come on board. We've had all sorts of indications from people in other countries of their interest, and it's been quite heartening. So I ask myself, why the difference in the reaction? Well, first of all, during the height of the Cold War, people were convinced, even though we had all of the close calls that Bill Perry outlined so dramatically, people were convinced that deterrence, the ability to wipe each other out, kept the peace. It was pretty tenuous. Ronald Reagan considered it immoral to think that we defend ourselves that way. But anyway, people thought that it worked. By now, when we published this article, as I see it, it jolted people. They sort of said, ever since the end of the Cold War, people have gone to sleep on this issue, and look what's been happening. As Sam puts it, we're going down the mountain, and we're going toward a situation of great danger, and people sort of suddenly perceive that. And so they're interested. I think also, and this is a lesson for moving ahead, people were struck by the series of steps that were outlined. That is, it seemed not just like a great idea somehow, but something that might actually be achieved, because there was a roadmap, and there were things that you could do, and you could see that they were doable. So I think that helped. And I think also there may be a sort of instinctive reaction, at least by people who work on the subject, to an improvement in our stance as we think ahead to the non-proliferation treaty review and other such efforts. In a way, if you say non-proliferation, that puts you in a defensive stance. You're trying to defend against something to stop it. And I think what we perhaps have achieved or are in the process of achieving, if we can go forward with this, is to capitalize on that old saying, the best defense is a good offense. So this puts us on the offensive. We're for something. And within that framework, you can talk about non-proliferation in a much more convincing way. So at any rate, I can't help but notice the difference in the reaction, and it's very heartwarming. I might say that we've published so far two things reflecting this work. And one of them, the first book, reprints in full the transcript of what was said at Reykjavik between Reagan and Gorbachev, and a few words by me and Shevardnadze, but the two leaders dominated the discussion totally. We also found a wonderful scholar at Stanford, David Holloway, dug around in the Hoover archives, and he found, amazingly, the instructions the Politburo gave to Gorbachev, including all of his red lines, as he went to Reykjavik. I read that, it's reprinted in here. I said, boy, what do I wish I'd had that document before we went. Now, second, what about implications for the future as far as our diplomacy is concerned? There are lots of things that need to be done, but what about our diplomacy? First of all, I would have to say to you that I believe we are ill-equipped. We're not nearly as well prepared as we should be to conduct the kind of imaginative global diplomacy steadily with people of high standing that can go. The Secretary of State or the Secretary of Defense can't do everything. You've got to have really able people, and they've got to have a support group that's strong. We need a much bigger foreign service. We need to try to get some of those wonderfully skilled people to come back. They're retiring at alarming levels, just when they're at the height of their powers. And we need to make it inviting for people who are the political appointees to come in. And of course, I remember when I was in office, I had the likes of Paul Nitze and John Whitehead and Chet Crocker and a lot of other people, Max Kampelman. These are big people. You have to have people like that where you can send them to a head of government anywhere and they get listened to, not just because they're representing the United States, but because they're Paul Nitze. So that everybody knows, you don't have to explain it to him twice, he gets it. And they know that when he comes home, everybody's gonna listen to what he has to say. So it's worth talking to him. And we have to strengthen ourselves dramatically compared with where we are right now. And then the second thing that it seems to me we have to do, and to some extent the composition of the panel illustrates it, I don't think you can really get anywhere in negotiating on this issue as, say, just a person like me. You have to be able to work alongside high-powered scientific people. It's got to be a joint enterprise, and that has to get built right in to our diplomacy. And I don't mean by that that we can aspire to attract lots of high-powered, really top-notch scientists to take full-time jobs in the government. That's probably out of the question. But at least in the experience I've had, if you have an important mission and they can come and work at it part-time or give a burst of attention, they're anxious to do it. They're willing to do it. It's not a problem. So we have to identify, I say, the Sidrells of this world. There aren't very many Sidrells, but anyway, there are lots of people who can be extremely helpful. And there's no point in sending a person who doesn't have a deep scientific training out to negotiate on these issues, because they intrinsically have a lot of content where you need somebody that understands it from the inside out. So that's another attribute of our diplomacy that I think needs to be developed very strongly. And it is an interesting, somewhat ironic development that the most eloquent spokesman for improving our diplomatic capability right now turns out to be the Secretary of Defense, Bob Gates, who talks about this all the time. I mean, he realizes how important it is. So these are just some reflections on reactions to Reykjavik as compared with now, and some thoughts about the kind of effort we need to make to improve our diplomatic capability if we're going to be able to support a president if he should want to go forward with this. And I might say it's wonderful to see that both candidates have pretty much endorsed this program, so I hope whoever loses will support whoever wins in going forward. As sometimes it is said to each of us, isn't this nice that this initiative is bipartisan? And we all say, really, it's not bipartisan. It's nonpartisan. This is not a subject to be dragged into Republicans versus Democrats. It's a subject to be debated on its merits among Americans and go forward on the merits. And that's the way we work at it. Well, once again, thank you for the honor, and thank you for the opportunity to talk to this distinguished group and to listen once again to my colleagues. I always learn from any association with these gentlemen.
I think it's clear that the statements we have just heard show yet again that all of these individuals are richly deserving of the Rumford Prize, and please join me in thanking them for all of their work.